that you wanted it to have.
That'll start at 1:30. But anyway, right now we have our wonderful panel here. I want to introduce Michael Simpson from the Newport Historical Society, who will be the moderator, and he will introduce our panelists. Michael has been key in reaching out to our leaders here and bringing them here, and he's worked with us together for the last year on this. So I really thank Mike for all his work. Well, of course, Robin Worthington got our speaker, keynote speaker. So anyway, this is Mike Simpson.
Hi everyone, thanks again for coming, and thanks again to Dr. Coby, Ron, and Robin for putting all of this together. I just want to real quickly let everyone know kind of the format for what we're going to be doing here. I'm going to let each of the speakers speak for about 12 minutes. After each speaker speaks, I'm going to allow maybe one or two questions, and then we'll move on to the next speaker. Once everyone has spoken for about 12 minutes, then we'll open up to live questions to everyone. So I ask just kind of, we do individual questions for each person, maybe one or two, and then we'll go on from there. So I'm going to start off with some introductions. Up front, we have Tall Oak Weeden. Tall Oak is Mashantucket Pequot and Wampanoag, and he is an elder, a survivalist, and a historian. I also want to make sure that I recognize all the members of Indian Country that did come today. I really appreciate you guys coming and showing your support to such what I think is such an important event. Up next we have Linda Coombs, who is Aquinnah Wampanoag. Linda worked for 11 years with the Boston Children's Museum, and then she spent 30 years working with the Wampanoag Indigenous Program at Plymouth Plantation, where she served as the program's associate director for 15 years. She is currently the director of the Aquinnah Cultural Center, whose mission is to preserve, interpret, and document the Aquinnah Wampanoag self-defined history, culture, and contributions of the past, present, and future. Up next we have Loren Spears. Loren is Narragansett Niantic. She has been an educator for over 25 years, teaching grades K through 8, and more recently as an adjunct professor at the University of Rhode Island. Since 2003, she has served as the executive director of the Tomaquag Museum in Exeter, Rhode Island's only indigenous-run museum. Under her leadership, the Tomaquag Museum received the Institute of Museum and Library Services National Medal. And more recently, Loren has been appointed by Governor Raimondo to serve on the board of the Rhode Island State Council on the Arts. As you know, if you look into the program, we did have two other speakers, Nancy Brown Garcia and Pam Ellis. They were both unfortunately unable to attend due to personal reasons. We do, however, have a wonderful replacement. Her name is Sheena Lee. Sheena is a member of the Shinnecok Nation of New York, and she has been working as an educator for over 15 years in Massachusetts and New York, when she graduated from Northeastern University, she began teaching in Boston, and is currently working with both natives and non-natives to educate the next generation. And with that, I'm going to turn over to Tall Oak to get started, of course. Actually, Tall Oak's going to lead us in an opening prayer to get us started. So I ask for everyone to be prepared for that.
With the rest of my family here, since I didn't realize I was going to have three generations of my family present, and I'm really pleased that everyone made that effort, because it means a lot to have your family, because of all we've been through to survive. And my youngest is my great-grandson that's here, his first conference.
All of my family members, other Indian friends that are here, can come forward and maybe make a circle. That's how we usually have a place. And then you go back to your respective seats. But this time, let us all put our hearts and our minds together in a good way, so that we can ask the Creator of all life, the one who has made all things, to help our words to reach into the hearts of everyone, so that together and individually, we can all leave here, everyone, everyone that's here in this auditorium, leave here with an enlightened mind and a commitment to join us in making this a better world. That's what's brought us together here. And I'm thankful to the campus for bringing us here. I've never been on this campus before. I won't forget my first visit, because especially at these times that we're living in now, when this country is in so much trouble because lessons were not learned. And we hope that we can bring those lessons to light so that we can all make this a better world. And I honor our ancestors, who if it wasn't for the sacrifices they made, we would never be here. So I give thanks to them and to the future generations that will go on from here and work with my family, my children, grandchildren, great-grandchildren, after I am put into the ground and travel to the spirit world. And I give thanks to the Creator for allowing me to survive 32 years since my cancer surgery. We had some work for me to do, and part of that work is to be here. So I don't take that for granted. Every day is a gift. I go to a lot of funerals, many younger than me. So I give thanks for all these things as I come together in a good way in this circle, and I hope we can accomplish what we came for, to make this a better world. Behave.
I'd like to talk about the whole concept of intent, because it kind of struck me as Dr. Jacoby was speaking that that's one of those things that gets thrown out there kind of as a smokescreen for what's really going on. It's usually when I give a presentation or a workshop or whatever, I always start with the doctrine of discovery. Are people in the room familiar with that? Could I see a show of hands as to who may have heard of that? Okay, fair enough. That was in 1452 when the Vatican issued statements that said, you know, Christians can go anywhere in the world and conquer non-Christians, take their lands, enslave them, do whatever you have to do, because what's theirs is yours because you're the Christian and they're not, and, you know, let fall what may. To me, that's intent. Because 50 years later, we had Columbus coming into this hemisphere, and he certainly had a specific intent in coming. And he did a lot of damage. He and his crews on his respective trips resulted in the deaths of tens of millions of native peoples. And, you know, a century or 120 years later, whatever, we have the pilgrims coming to this area. And they came into Wampanoag territory, and we had already lost 75 to 90% of our population due to one of those inadvertent plagues. And I say inadvertent in quotes because people in Europe did know prior to the 17th century that these illnesses were contagious. They understood that one person can affect another. So it's just interesting that they intended to end up in Virginia and somehow ended up in here, where the land, as they subsequently put it, was cleared for a better people. And the other thing that was going on that initiated or helped to initiate their voyage over here was the fact that they'd been granted a land patent by the King of England. And if you read that document, it goes on to describe, you know, all the latitude and longitude and all the ponds and rivers and inlets and mountains and hills and ant hills and you know, anything else we had going on here, you know, very specifically. It's difficult to read because it's in 17th century English, and it's like just one long thing, no paragraphs or anything, but you can certainly get the gist of what they're saying, that all of this land, from sea to sea, was belonged now to the English crown. That's intent. So all of these discussions about what came after and how the land was gotten, to me it's almost frivolous in a way, because the English came here and right away, you know, started to obtain the land. And if they couldn't get it through method A, they went to B. And if that didn't work, they went to C. There were issues where the land belonged to the women, or the, you know, or if the sachem of a village, for example, Weedamo was, you know, the sachem was a woman. They tried to go through a male relative. And even Massasoit at one point told the English, I can't, that's Weedamo's land, I can't give it to you. You know, because of the way that they felt about women. So to me, all of that is intent. And I think, you know, it's just time after all of these years to start to call it what it is. I don't want to start any fights or anything out here, but I am on the board of Plymouth 400, which is, if you have not heard of it, an organization that is preparing events and activities for the 400th anniversary of the landing of the Mayflower. And as I've often told visitors to the Aquinnah Cultural Center, that is not high on our list of priorities to you know, celebrate the arrival of the pilgrims, but it is a national and an international stage for us to get our message out. And as a result of being on the board, one of the people that I met with and was invited to sit down and have a discussion with was the national head of the General Society of Mayflower Descendants. And as I suspected it might be, it was an interesting conversation. Because she was fully you know, engaged in believing that there was 40 years of peace or 50 years of peace, which again, I think is just silly. Because if there were 50 years of peace, then why did King Philip's War happen? If everything's going along good, then, oh, shucks, I'm bored, let's have a war, you know? It just didn't happen like that. And if you, you know, get into the history, and it is out there. I've had so many teachers, you know, say that, or other people, well, it's not written down. Well, it is. You just have to know where and how to find it. It is out there. And it's a story of just, you know, one encroachment after another after another. They just kept pushing and pushing and pushing. And long story short, since I only have a few moments, this summer I'm going to be co-teaching a teacher institute put on by UMass Amherst. And we had 25 slots that we could ask teachers to, you know, attend this institute. And we received 225 applications. The name of the workshop is Key Concepts in Teaching Native American Histories. And we were surprised, we were blown away by the amount of response. And every person that applied had to write an essay of no more than 4 pages. And almost to a person, they were saying, well, when I was in school, I never had any sort of Native studies. We did pilgrims and turkeys and one or two Indians in the third grade. And then in high school, there's the paragraph on the Aztecs on page 793, you know, on the back of the history book, and that's about it. And one person said that she was 25 years old and in graduate school before she ever heard about King Philip's War. Everyone is saying that they didn't get it when they were in school, and they're not being, you know, mandated or asked to include it in the curriculum now, other than very minimal stuff that they feel ill-equipped to teach, hence the response to the workshop. There was a person from one state who even said that the state declared that Native studies are non-essential, which makes me feel, and all of us, I think, more essential than ever. Because just as human beings, we are essential. Period. So whatever comes through us, whatever comes with us as our histories is also essential. And I, in my mind, in my career, Native history, you cannot understand American history unless you have an understanding of all of the Native history, starting with us, moving right across the country to the other coast, Canada, Alaska, wherever. Unless you understand the interaction of the Europeans with us at whatever point we made contact, you don't understand American history. Thank you.
After everybody's voices. So if anyone has any questions, I encourage you to go over to these two.
Thank you for having me. I'm curious, with the response that you received from this workshop that will be happening this summer, is this something that you intend to offer again? I know I'm speaking for myself that's something that I would like to apply for. I didn't realize that the workshop was being offered this summer. Otherwise, I most likely would have submitted an application as well.
The workshop is being funded by NEH, the National Endowment for the Humanities. So whether we'll offer it again, at least through NEH, will remain to be seen. You know, we can certainly hopefully find other sources of funding or offer it in a different format or in different sections or, you know, things like that. So
thank you very much.
Any other questions? For now? Okay, cool. We'll move on to the next, Loren.
One of those topics, there's just so much to say, it's almost hard to begin. And so many interesting things. You know, when I think about just genocide in general of our people, it just is so interwoven in every facet of who we are today, and it impacts us in so many different ways. I mean, we've talked about already the obvious things of the germ warfare. I'm with Linda on that there's lots of intent. If you look at Columbus's diaries and you read them, in it he states that was a known war tactic. If he can know it in the 1400s, they can know it in the 1600s. So I feel that it was certainly an intent to eradicate indigenous peoples. And as you go along in the strategies that took place, I look at just, I'm Narragansett from Rhode Island, and so I'll use some Rhode Island examples. But when the colonial charter was made for the colony of Rhode Island, in the charter, it says that the colonial power had the right to enslave and kill the indigenous peoples of that land. So if that's in those charters, there's a clear intent. And I'm a firm believer, if you're doing it one place, first contact places, you're doing it clear across the country. And so the intent was pure genocide of our people. What happened is maybe there were a lot more of us here than they thought, and it took longer and it was harder for them to do, so then they found other tactics in which to try to get rid of us, whether that was overt warfare. We've already talked about King Philip's War, and I have a bit of a pet peeve. And the pet peeve is that a lot of times when historians are talking about massacres, they like to talk about the massacres that happened in the late 1800s, and mind you, no offense to those communities that this is happening to, but there's a bit of erasure that happens in American history, and anything on the East Coast gets erased and gets forgotten. And hundreds of people in the Narragansett communities and the Wampanoag communities were killed during King Philip's War and in the Great Swamp Massacre. Never mind, let's go back a little bit to the Pequot Massacre. And so all up and down the East Coast, there were these massacres that are often overlooked, and people, especially scholars in my opinion, that are talking about massacres sort of forget about the East Coast. And so that just really sort of infuriates me. And so with that, you know, that content about intent, intent really does kind of, I was sitting over there and I started cringing every which way, because it is a strategy of erasure, and by saying that someone has to have an intent or it has to be proven. Well, modern day science is another way of erasing indigenous people, because anthropologists and archaeologists have been saying all kinds of things about indigenous people that aren't true because they couldn't prove it. And I'll give an example that I think is absolutely ludicrous. For years and years and years, they said the Narragansett people didn't eat corn. Well, finally, they had the archaeological site, which is known as 110, and it's the salt pond site, and lo and behold, they found this huge corn cache. Now they're not so sure we ate squash, because there was only one little tiny seed left that they couldn't quite do the science on. So I share that because just because they say it and they're supposedly the experts doesn't mean it's true. And I think that the notion of intent and proving that intent, I think we very easily can, but if the historians feel that they cannot, by their rules of research, I think that's just another tactic for erasure of our people. And so, along with the ones that have been historically done that are overt, like displacement and removal policies and obvious land dispossession, those kinds of things, but then there's the enslavement. There's the enslavement in your own homeland, and as a Narragansett person in Rhode Island, our people were enslaved in what is now known as Rhode Island and the Providence plantations. And I'm on my own one-person crusade. Everywhere I go, I say change the name, because we're still harkening back to an oppressive time period. Most people in the country don't even know Rhode Island had that fancy long name. And the people in Rhode Island, probably 75% don't know, from my own informal interviewing, that we're keeping an oppressor's title on the name of this country, on the name of our state, that was about enslaving people, African-descended people and indigenous people of our homeland. But not only that, but sending our people into slavery, into the Caribbean. You know, we've had some healing that has happened, having that wonderful reconnection, which Tall Oak was on the front lines of, with the folks at St. David's Island in Bermuda. And for me, as someone who's 50 this year and kind of in the middle road of age, I feel really blessed to have been part of that and to have that reconnection, that my children have met family that now live in Bermuda. And the way that we feel about each other is exactly that, family. They come to our homes, we go to their homes, and that's one little glimmer of healing from the atrocities that have taken place. We all know about the forced assimilative practices and the forced acculturation and the forced Christianization. All of those things are part of the genocide. You know, you can call it cultural genocide, you can call it whatever you want, but it's about stripping us of our whole entity of being who we are. And to me, there's so many different kinds of genocide have been mentioned, and a couple of things, I've got to put some glasses on because I can't see, that caught my attention. There was a term called utilitarian genocide, and it's the aim is for some form of material gain, such as the seizure of territory in order to gain control of economic resources for commercial exploitation. Well, we know that's the truth. However, there was another definition, and I'm loosely quoting this one, but it was indigenous genocide. And it's the destruction of way of life, and colonists imposed their way of life on indigenous people. And so that's another layer of the same genocide, because when you talk about genocide, people get really literal about the death of people, which we've had, millions and millions of us. But there's this other layer of genocide that I think sometimes gets overlooked that I think is really, really important. And I feel that all of these things are connected to each other, and sometimes when people look at the assimilated practices and they go, well, that has nothing to do with genocide, but yes, it does. It has a direct link. Never mind that we have the fallout and the historical trauma of that and the highest rate of suicide from that, because we're still trying to heal our wounds of hundreds of years that keep getting compounded. But I have to go backwards a moment. Back to the Declaration of Independence. So, Paul here, relative of mine, whom I love dearly, we have one of his art pieces in our museum in an exhibit called The Pursuit of Happiness in an Indigenous View. which my mother, Dawn Dove, over there, was the lead curator of that exhibit. And one of the most powerful things in that exhibit, and you know, I've been an educator a long time. You all are smart people, I'm sure. You know, at some point in your life, you were forced to read the Declaration of Independence. And yeah, we remember Life, Liberty, the Pursuit of Happiness, and John Hancock was the first one to sign it. That's what most people can remember. But then, if you're Tall Oak, you pull some stuff out, so you learn some things from Tall Oak, right? So it stuck with me, and this is something that myself, as an educator in the museum, and every educator that is trained in our museum is brought right over to and shown and made to represent, because it's so important for people to understand these things. That in the Declaration of Independence, the doctrine that makes this a country, it says, well, three quarters way down the first line of it, that one of the major goals is raising the conditions of new appropriations of land. So there's back to that utilitarian genocide and the aim for that material gain. And then it continues on, you know, skip a little bit, and it says, and I quote, has endeavored to bring upon the inhabitants of our frontiers, and I've got to put three triple lines under the word our, and then bold it and highlight it, because they're talking about the people that signed that document as our frontiers, the merciless Indian savages whose known rules of warfare is an undistinguished destruction of all ages, sexes, and conditions. And talk about intent. The intent is there. The goal for the resources, the land, what resources were within the land is there. The intent for genocide is there because then they vilified, demonized, and dehumanized our people in order to justify what was going to come next. And I often think of four words that really encapsulates all of this. Greed, power, and we already know what the greed is for the materials and resources, but power. The power is not just monetary power, but it's also that notion of, you know, someone over there, the king and queen of wherever, that has that sort of authority and their version of power. And I connect it very closely with entitlement, because it's that notion that Christopher Columbus, we'll use him as the example, can go someplace, shove a stick in the ground with a flag on it and say it belongs to them, because they feel so entitled based on the power, their version of power and structure, that they are entitled to those resources and those lands and to dispossess the people and kill and enslave them. And then, interestingly enough, I taught a class at the University of Rhode Island teaching indigenous literature, and in order to get the students to understand the history that's wrapped up in that literature, we had to do a lot of conversations. And one of them was sort of about perspective, and I brought up this issue of greed, power, and entitlement. And in the discussion, the students actually came up with a fourth one that was absolutely critical. And ever since then, I've kept that in my thinking. And it's the fourth one is fear. Because see, in the Declaration of Independence, through that propaganda, they created fear of the people that were here. And they dehumanized them, they vilified them, they did everything they could to make it so that when people came, just the average Joe that doesn't know all the strings that are being pulled and all the manipulation that's being happened, that they're fearful of us before they even start. And so it leads to the justification, well, it's my land, I was given it by the government, and now these people or these creatures, whatever they were thinking of us, are trying to take it away from me, and I'm going to protect it, and I'm fearful for my family, and I've been told all these horror stories about captures and this, that, and the other thing. And so fear is very much put into the propaganda to make people do the thing that the power players want you to do. So, I mean, there's so many pieces to this, and I feel like some of the pieces that really just make me so angry is that there's so many government policies that were embedded into this that they always seem to say aren't written in the history, but yet seem to be pop up in all different kinds of places, whether that's policies for genocide overtly, or whether that's policies of genocide through eugenics. We know that, I mean, in the 1800s, there was a big movement for eugenics within Indian communities. We also know in the 1970s there was a major push again where thousands and thousands of indigenous women were sterilized, you know, involuntary hysterectomies and tubal ligations and things of that nature. They even used some pill, I'll call it, quiacrin capsules to destroy fallopian tubes. These are things, like, people always say to me, because I work in a museum, I've even had someone actually say exactly these words, get over it, it happened a long time ago. But this is not true. This is not over, because we keep getting sucked back into a cycle that keeps happening again and again. When you talk about eugenics in the 1800s, and then you talk about eugenics in the 1970s, who knows what's happening today when people are being manipulated and lied to and told one thing and something else is happening. Who has the power, you know, and is controlling these things? And so, you know, I think that there's so many, this is such a complex issue. If you're very singular, you think of genocide as the death of a people. But if you're more broad in that definition, it's the death of the people or the death of their culture, the death of their beliefs, the death of everything that is the entity, the essence, I meant to say, of who they are as people. To try to counteract that, we look at the historical trauma as indigenous people, and we try to unpack, if you will, these things. I mentioned, you know, the relationship with Bermuda as being something that you can do to try to unpack some of that. There's so many different things, that's another whole story, I won't go too far in that direction, that we're trying to do to unpack that. But the healing starts truly with acknowledgement, not just verbalization of it, but the deep understanding of what's transpired and what has happened to our people, not solely by people that are not of our culture, but even for ourselves, for us to have these conversations and to look at these things and the impact that they have on our people. Because people will come to me, you know, all of us are in visible places where we work, and people will say, well, you know, you've got dysfunction in your community for this reason or that. And I'm like, yes, as every family does, because tribal communities are a great big family. However, we're carrying all this baggage of enslavement and genocide and displacement and forced acculturation and your children being ripped out of your homes and sent to boarding schools. You know, when you say that, people go, oh, your kids went to a boarding school. They get visions of Switzerland or something in their head. And they don't realize that your children were forcibly taken and then told everything about them was bad, and they're not allowed to speak their language, practice their cultures, practice their religion, wear their clothes, wear their hair the way that is traditional for them, to be anything to do with what they are, and told everything that they are is bad, you know, and then kept there for extended periods of time. And some of the documents I saw, just some of the boarding schools in Connecticut, and then of course we all know famous Carlisle. And I know in our own archive we have Narragansett children that were in Carlisle. They were taken for years. This isn't 2017 where you can hop on a plane or a bus and get home. This is, you know, 16, 17, 1800s, and you're gone for years. So with that, I'll just leave you with thinking about how much pain we all carry and how the genocide of our people, physically and mentally and emotionally and spiritually, weighs on us today.
Thank you very much.
I just want to add something to this, because it has to deal with the two commonwealths of the United States, which is the Commonwealth of Virginia and the Commonwealth of Massachusetts. And we're called the Commonwealth because our Constitution still reflects our connection to the And I want to add another genocide, the genocide that Walter, and I would like everybody to write his name down, Walter Ashley, A-S-H-L-E-Y, Plecker, P-L-E-C-K-E-R, who was the genocide for the Commonwealth of Virginia, who instructed all of his clerks whenever they saw a birth, marriage, or death certificate that said Native on them or Indian, to change them all to black. So that's the beginning of our paper genocide. Thank you.
I lost my thoughts. Because as a teacher, paper genocide is so clear. First, we're written right out of it completely. As Linda mentioned, I mean, I go around saying there is no U.S. history without Indigenous history. There is no Rhode Island history without the Indigenous peoples, the first peoples, the Narragansett, the Niantic, even the Wampanoag, as we kind of felt. But we didn't make the lines that are here today. Not only is it genocide by omission, but it's genocide by the overt lies. And the lies can be cloaked in different kinds of ways. There's the sanitized version, there's the romanticized version, there's the glamorized version. I don't know, there's a few more of those eyes in there and that they do in text. And you know, Linda's right, the teachers are like, well, it's hard to come across the resources. I do agree that with Linda that they're there. They're a little harder to come by. There's more places today than there once was. What's the name of the publishing company? .org is a great resource. It's not the only resource, but it's a great sort of national resource of books that are written by Indigenous people and that have been vetted by a team of librarians and educators for resources. But I mean, I'm sure each of us can talk a while on pencil genocide. And you know, there's a great book, The Lies My Teacher Told Me. I forgot who the author is off the top of my head, but
James Lowen.
You know, things like that. Because the reality is, we like to have the sound bites. You know, in Rhode Island, as it was mentioned earlier, they love Columbus Day, and I've been trying to really kind of attack this in a different way. It's not that we're against Italian culture and tradition. We, you know, as an Indigenous person living in the 21st century, you know, this Italian culture is wonderful. There's lots of great things. But why are we idolizing this one person that's supposedly from Italy that came here and did everything he could possibly do that was wrong in the world? And we're going to put him on a pedestal and say he's great for genocide and displacement and horror. You know, something like 20 men to subjugate a whole group when he was on Hispaniola. I mean, that's something you're proud about. After you said they were so nice and so welcoming and fed us and took us in and did all these great things, and then you're proud of that. I think that people today, because we get caught in the romanticized history, we get caught into the fiction of it. And many people don't even know the true story, so they get caught in that. And people feel that when Indigenous people and scholars are saying we shouldn't celebrate Columbus Day, that we're attacking Italian culture. And I'm saying we're not attacking Italian culture. If you want to have an Italian culture day that respects and honors the great contributions to the world from Italian culture, then do that. But don't celebrate someone who went across the world through a destructive path in invoking genocide and enslavement of millions of people.
Thank you, Loren. I'm going to pass it on to Sheena. Go ahead, take it.
First of all, I just want to thank you for having this conference. I have a question, just kind of going into something that you had mentioned about, I guess, genocide more in our lifetime. And I'm actually a native Rhode Islander. I just moved back to the area after being 12 years in Maine, and I worked with the Wabanaki Confederacy, the Penobscot, Passamaquoddy, Mi'kmaq, and Maliseet communities for quite some time. And one of the things that I felt so frustrated with, and I'm hoping that you can kind of just shed some light on your own experiences, is the genocide that's happening now. I'm really good friends with Maria Gerard, who's a Native American activist in the Penobscot community. And the Penobscots in Maine have been going through a whole, I guess you could say, water rights dispute with the state that's, you know, about pollution, it's about fishing rights. And she said that it was, you know, this was a form of genocide on that community. And this is happening right now when we're seeing with the Dakota Access Pipeline too. And I found myself, you know, as Maria was going around into non-Native communities trying to say, we need help. We need help for you guys to be allies with us. And I'm finding myself in conversation and debates with people that are in academics saying, come on, this is a real issue. This is a form of genocide. They're taking away their water rights. they're polluting the water, the state knows about it, and then we have communities that, non-Native people, that are really good people, and who acknowledge previous past genocides, but don't get that it's happening today. And I find myself frustrated because I want to be able to educate non-Native people that this is happening, like the Dakota Access Pipeline. This is about water. What are you gonna do when you cut off the water to a community? You know, that your water is life. So, and you're seeing this with more and more communities today. And so for my friend Maria to say this is a form of genocide and for people not to see it, I'd just like to get your thoughts on this, because I'm not sure what your communities are dealing with in terms of sovereignty issues, but these are also, according to other Native people, genocide issues. And I would tend to agree, because when you go after communities' basic right, you know, access to water, you're fighting against a community. So I find that the genocide tactics are changing. They're being camouflaged. They're not being, you know, it's not, you know, massive killing. It's going after, you know, your food, your water, your cultural survival. Thank you.
We're all in agreement that the attack on the earth is an attack on us as well. And why humanity doesn't see it as an attack on them, you know, all of us as humans, I don't understand. But certainly, you know, Standing Rock is a very visible example of this, but all across the nation, indigenous communities are being attacked and polluted, whether that's the mining and the waters. I mean, there's just so many, my head just almost imploded just then, I can't even get anything out. That, you know, it is an attack on us, and the sovereignty issues, I mean, we've been being attacked and attacked and attacked. I mean, specifically, I mean, across the nation, sovereign rights are being attacked, but I can speak to the Narragansett in particular. I mean, we are a unique circumstance, and we have been stripped and stripped and stripped and stripped again. And it's, you know, the politics that be, I go back to greed, power, entitlement, and fear. And in Rhode Island, they've used all four of those things over and over and over again against the Narragansett people. And when you think about Standing Rock, I mean, I was in D.C. just a couple of weeks ago at that rally. There were thousands and thousands of people. There wasn't a peep on the news. There wasn't a peep at all. If you were watching, maybe listening to NPR, you might have got a little bit more, but the only way you really saw anything is if you were online and you were watching people that were posting live streaming, because they just hide that like crazy. And, you know, there's such an attack. I mean, we're living in a world that's being attacked every which way, and there's this notion that there's nothing happening with climate change and it's all a hoax. That's just an attack as well. You know, our families and communities, maybe in the southern New England area, we're not completely subsistence living, but I always like to say we're subsistence supporting our diets. Our families are still hunting, fishing, gathering, planting, you know, and living off this landscape. But how can we do that when we're finding out that our ponds are polluted with PCBs and lead? And so we're trying to deal with that just on our singular tribal level, that issue. What is that going to do? What is it? How is it affecting our people? Is it already harming us individually? And where did these toxins come from? You know, from colonial businesses and, you know, industrial businesses and things like that came before this time. So we're all being impacted by these things, and you're right, it's all an attack because we're dying. But I have to say one more thing that's kind of a little bit off topic, and it's that indigenous people are being killed as we're sitting here. There, and women and men, but there's an attack on indigenous women across this nation and up through Canada, where they're just disappearing off the planet and are being victimized and abused and left dead in the woods and on the street and on the highways. And we ignore this as humans, and it's going on as we speak. They're being sold into the sex trade and our
overseas.
Say that again.
They're being taken overseas.
They're being taken overseas. And you know, this has to be acknowledged that enslavement and genocide is happening right now, today.
We're trying to stay on task here with time, so I'm going to give it to Sheena.
Hello. I am Sheena Lee. I'm from the Shinnecok Nation. I am Harriet Starley Crippen Gums's granddaughter, Lance Fierce-Eyes Gums, his daughter. And I'm here to, you know, represent on behalf of Nancy Brown, who unfortunately is not able to make it today. So she has passed along some of her notes, and then I have, you know, some of my own notes and comments to add to the discussion today. Before I even start, I just want to say thank you for the honor to be on such a distinguished panel. You know, I've grown up hearing these names and, you know, hearing stories of these wonderful people and the work that they've done. And so it's a real honor to be here for you guys to carry on that tradition. And, you know, as Mike mentioned in my introduction, one of my goals is to educate the next generation. And I am the next generation. and I am the seventh generation. And my generation has, you know, we're kicking the doors off of this. And we have every intention of making the voice and making our mission and our thoughts and our ideas and our history known. And so, you know, like I said, it's an honor to be sitting here with these wonderful women and this elder of mine to talk to you guys today. So I guess to get started, we're going to take a little trip down 95 because I am from New York. I'm from Long Island, from the Shinnecok tribe. I also, you know, we talk about this idea of, you know, tribes and nations disappearing, but I'm also Montauket, which is another branch of, you know, of the Algonquin people that is sort of not really acknowledged, but they were, you know, two different tribes, and, you know, although we all were part of one larger confederacy, with Chief Wyandanch and some of the other, you know, amazing sachems and chiefs. So it's interesting to be sitting here talking to, you know, Narragansett and Mashpee and Wampanoag, because, you know, we were all the same people. You know, we fished the same waters. The Long Island Sound was our highway. We, you know, we had each other's backs during war. And so to be here in Massachusetts has been a very interesting experience for me because I'm finding more and more and more as I learn more and more that, you know, we are so connected that, you know, the stories that I would hear about, you know, King Philip's War and, you know, the genocide and things that took place here in Massachusetts and Rhode Island, that was my people as well, you know, and so, you know, if we go back to Minigret and some of the other people who, the other sachems who, you know, sort of had a handle on, you know, on all of the tribes in the area, it all comes back, you know, to the same points. And so, you know, we'll take a trip down 95 and we talk about, you know, the purchase and, you know, what happened in Manhattan. You know, if we look to see what's there now, it's buildings and you know, life in the fast lane, and, you know, before that it was swamp, and, you know, the island of Manhattan was sort of an inhospitable, you know, non-inhabited, kind of non-inhabited place. And what we find, and, you know, these are some of Nancy's findings, so I, you know, have to honor that, that it wasn't so much the Christians in New York, so much of that there was a large Jewish population that had been sort of removed, you know, they've been chased out of Europe, they've been chased, you know, from their homes, their ancestral lands in the Middle East, and, you know, pushed out of France and Egypt and Portugal and England, and they were pushed eventually, you know, here in Massachusetts and Rhode Island, and of course they were then pushed out again, and they sort of made their way down to where the Dutch were, and what we find now is that the Jews, for lack of a better way to say it, they, in their desperation to find a stronghold, in their desperation to, you know, finally have a place to settle, were very successful in pushing all of the natives out of that area, the Lenape, the you know, the Shinnecok, you know, they eventually made their way out to the eastern part of Long Island, where they set up strongholds. Southampton, which is where I'm from, is, if you look to see, you know, the history of Southampton, and if there's a ton of, you know, Jewish families who came from, you know, Manhattan and made their way, trickled their way out to the eastern tips of Long Island. And so, you know, what Nancy has shared with me is that, you know, everybody talks about the Christians and, you know, the different sectors that came and had influence in removing, you know, natives from their land and things of that nature. But there's, you know, a group of people that we all forget about. And the genocide and the massacres and things that occurred with the Jewish community that moved to Manhattan isn't really talked about, because there's belief that the Jews were ashamed of what they had done. They had been a peaceful people for thousands and thousands of years, but in an act of desperation, they did what they had to do to make sure that Manhattan stayed theirs. And so, even if we look today, you know, I'm part of the, have been asked to be the director of the National Algonquin Indian Council, and as part of what we're trying to do is to sort of collect the history of New York and to collect the history of the people who lived in that area. And my grandmother, Harriet Crippen, she was, you know, spearheaded that a long time ago, and I'm just now learning these fascinating things about my lineage and my family. And, you know, to know that my grandmother had a huge part in trying to maintain that history and that genealogy and the stories and the truth about what happened, you know, with the purchasing of Manhattan and the beads and $24 and things of that nature. You know, so it's an honor for me, you know, to be able to share these things with you as I'm just coming to learn them, as I've gotten older and I'm, you know, exploring, you know, these things that I was never told. You know, I'm an educator, I work in Boston, and we, you know, many people have mentioned, you know, there's no way to find these things to teach people. Well, there's no way for me, if there wasn't any way for me to find these things so I could learn them for myself. You know, I'm very fortunate now to have people who are, you know, teaching me these things. And so when we talk about this paper genocide, you know, even things as far as these records and the historical books that are documented in the paper trail that does document these things, you know, some of her findings is that they're all being purchased, and they're all being purchased by Jewish people. And part of the reason is that because there's a Jewish law that history cannot be destroyed. So in an effort to eradicate it, they're purchasing all of it, and I don't know what they're doing with it, but we don't have access to it. And, you know, these books and these, you know, documents and things like that are hidden and tucked away. And, you know, so to find these things out is incredible, because I didn't know this, you know. And so we talk about the fallout, I guess, of genocide, is that now here I am, you know, seven generations later, and I'm grasping at every straw that I can get my hands on to try to educate myself, and then to educate, you know, my nieces and my nephews and things, and you know, even the children that I work with in Boston, who are learning, you know, God knows what. You know, I look at the curriculum that they're using to teach students in New York and here in Massachusetts, and it doesn't contain anything. Yeah, we lived in Wikileaks, we fish and yet, et cetera, but there's nothing there. There's no meat and potatoes. And so I'm, you know, I think about, you know, how connected we all are, and how I used to think that, you know, the Narragansett story, the Wampanoag story wasn't, you know, yeah, it was there in Massachusetts, there in Rhode Island, but now that my residence is here, I'm finding out just how interconnected and interwoven it really, really is. And, you know, as Mike mentioned, you know, one of my missions is to really educate people, so I'm intrigued that they're doing the conference at Amherst. I wish I had known about it, because I would apply for it. But I just think, you know, when we look at genocide as a whole, there's so many different things that I could have said to piggyback and to, you know, bounce off of what has been mentioned previously, but when I look at genocide and what it means for me, it's a very personal thing, because, you know, we talk about this historical trauma and being able to have these conversations. Someone asked earlier, well, how do we have these conversations? How do we do this? Well, we start by having things like this, conversations, being honest, tracking down ancient books that people have forgotten about, you know, reclaiming some of that history that has been lost. I actually just looked on my phone, you know, because we're addicted to our phones now, and Nancy had mentioned something to me that if you look up and if you, you know, Google it, if you Google Chief Manhattan, Manahatta, you know, who's the island of Manhattan and those, you know, that branch of people that live there, you can't find him anymore. And the only reason that I even know anything about it is because of what my mother and what my grandmother and my parents and family have told me about Broadway being, you know, one of the main trails that led down to the fishing grounds, which is now Battery Park and things of that nature. And, you know, if you look at the map of Manhattan, you know, Broadway, and I can't remember what the other one is, they come straight down the island to where the fishing grounds were. And, you know, I only reason I know that is because somebody told me. But if you Google it now, I could not find anything. I mean, and I typed in Chief Thiersaz, I typed in Manhattan, I typed it all in. There's nothing. There's literally nothing. And so I just, you know, I just think it's, I mean, and that's right now. So if, even if I wanted to pull up something from my students in my classroom, even if I wanted to Google it, I can't. It's not there. I would love to be able to tell them, yeah, I grew, you know, my father is named after, you know, Chief Thiersaz, and, you know, I'd love to be able to share that with them and hear, you know, here's the story of him, et cetera, et cetera, and I can't do that. So it's, you know, if we talk of this genocide, again, it's not necessarily this, you know, idea of mass extermination of people. It's a mass extermination of ideas, of beliefs, of practices, of knowledge, of lineage, of connection. And so I, you know, I have my, like, plethora of notes here, but, you know, even in terms of someone mentioned, I believe Mr. Jacoby mentioned alcohol and, you know, things of that nature that were used for genocide. You know, I think about my own generation and the things that we struggle with. And, you know, I have this book here that I was looking at it. You know, it's, and we talk about this paper trail and things being documented. Well, it's very well documented that in town meetings, in doing deals and tradings and things of that nature, alcohol was freely available, even from the Christian people, you know, Christian people providing, you know, copious amounts of alcohol, get them all liquored up, and then they'd sign the documents that they couldn't read anyway. And now, you know, through generations, that simple concept of, oh, give them a drink and they'll sign the paper is something that we struggle with, you know. And so I just, you know, I think about all of these things that people have said, you know, Thanksgiving, you know, we talk about Thanksgiving, someone mentioned that, and, you know, what do we teach about that? You know, and the documents of the Declaration of Independence, well, I've recently come to find that there's a document basically advertising, here, come to Massachusetts, and, you know, the life is plenty, and, you know, there's kind natives here, and then we go years later in the Declaration of Independence, and now it's totally swapped, you know. There's no come here, it's the free land, it's advertising, let's come here, let's celebrate, you know, there's great feasts and things of that nature. Now it's fear. It's, you know, come here, we'll eradicate them, we'll get rid of them, and then everybody can go on and live their lives. So I know I kind of zigzag all over the place, but I had to piece this together sort of on the fly. So I guess that kind of just, for me, it's very much a personal thing, the idea of genocide, and even when I teach my students, Native, non-Native, and even me myself as a scholar, you know, I just think it's so important. We just have to have these conversations, and we have to be honest about it. And the only way that it's going to stop is if we acknowledge that it's happening, period. Thank you.
All right, I don't see anyone. Do we have any questions?
There was a woman.
Is that you have no records of, you know, what you were taught
his story because it's his story. So whoever's in charge gets to write the books and gets to decide what gets put out there. Like I said, the only reason I really know these things is through oral tradition and maybe a blurb in a textbook. And so, you know, if we aren't in control of what's being published and what's being put out there, people can say whatever they want, especially nowadays. So I think there's an effort to hide it. I think there's an effort to hide it because knowledge is power, Schoolhouse Rocky told me. And so I think there's, you know, I think there is an active effort, just like there was in the past, to hide these things and to, because if you have the knowledge, you can do what you want with it, but if you can hide it. I genuinely do believe that. And I think, I read an article in the New York Post back in, I think it was December, where there was this eccentric millionaire in New York City, this Jewish man, who up and decided to give, you know, the Lenape, or I'm sorry, I may be misquoting it, but basically decided to turn over this like $1 million mansion to indigenous peoples and to Manhattan. And it's like, why would this, you know, eccentric millionaire do something like that? And he said it was because of, you know, the atrocities and the things, the lies and things that had taken place with his people. And you can Google it, it's the New York Post, there's a whole bunch of things on it, I can't remember the gentleman's name, but I do think that there has always been an active effort to hide things. And like I said, we're here to kick it down and find out what's underneath the carpet.
Hi, Sheena. As you said, Manhattan was sold for $24. And if for example, if the Native American hired a fund manager to compound that interest by 7%, it would be $7
billion. Yeah.
So you could buy all the farmland in the United States and also all most of the gold in the world. My question is, are there any foundations or are the Native Americans working with any fund managers to kind of pool all the resources, because land is very important. Is there any organization that's doing the fund?
Not that I know of. I mean, please, by all means, correct me if I'm wrong, but not that I know of. I mean, from what I can tell, it's just organizations and nations working collectively to try to rectify some of those infractions.
Okay. And there are a few land trusts that have come up in Native communities as of late as another way of managing the land.
And my last question is there anybody working with like these multimillionaire environmentalists like Jeremy Grantham up in Boston?
I've never heard of him.
Okay.
Was it Jeremy Grantham?
Yeah, GMO, Grantham Mayo Vanatula. So.
Well, I know that, not that I know of. I mean, I know personally the Shinnecok Nation. I mean, we are in a constant battle for land rights and things of that nature, and it's mostly just been tribally funded, grant funded, things of that nature. You know, our shorelines, our beaches, our waters. We're in constant battle. And the Montauk as well are in constant battle about what should be preserved and what should be, you know, kept and explored and, done archaeologically, done the right way so that if there is, you know, artifacts or things of that nature that we can, you know, find out the correct way instead of just digging it all up or tearing it down to build $1 million age.
Thank you.
Before you leave, if you're aware of resources like that.
I was going to say the same thing. Seems like you know
some
people.
Maybe you could compile a list of what you know about that our people don't know about and forward them to the planners of the conference here, and we could put it on the mailing list.
Sure.
Each of the panel.
Yeah, absolutely.
I work with low-income, first-generation college-bound students, Rockwood bound, but it's just general knowledge that, because we always start from the top,
You know, there's also an organization called Land is Life, which is an international organization with they focus on indigenous rights. They're based out of Brooklyn, but they're truly global. So they're not just Native Americans by any means. But I would definitely check them out. We're on time, so if we can make them as quick as possible, that would be fantastic.
I just had two resources to suggest, and one is I teach history here, and we're teaching. You know, naturally you show the map of the United States to the students, but if you look up the tribal sovereignty in the United States and ask for Google for that image, you get a map that's like Swiss cheese, where it shows where all the sovereign Native nations are, and so that the students who are studying this solid map of the United States, that's really not even accurate. We have places that are the other nations that live here. And the other thing is, you mentioned Maine and the Penobscots, but the Wabanakis have a webpage called Maine Wabanaki Reach, which they send out emails very, very often telling about all of the people working together to help some of the water issues that you mentioned in the state of Maine. So you can Google that, Maine Wabanaki Reach. Thank you.
Thank you. And we're just going to get to Tall Oak, and then we can have some final questions after that. We'll open it up to everybody. So, Tall Oak, do you want to take it away?
Before I begin what I have to say, I'd like my son David in the drum, the big powwow drum, and the drummers that are with him, to position themselves in this first row before I start to speak. So that he wrote a book called A Key into the Language of America. It's a fantastic little book. And I never dreamed when I found it in the school library in high school, my senior year, that I would ever own my own copy, let alone more than one copy. But at the end of each chapter, he ended with a poetic verse. So in his poetic way of expressing this, here's a Narragansett prophecy, he quoted. Oft have I heard these Indians say, my obligation is to speak for my ancestors who have paid with their blood for what little we may have today, and to hold on to it best we can for our generations yet unborn. This is how we honor our ancestors, for we are the zoom lens that illuminates and magnifies what needs to be seen clearly within the culture of deception and denial that we are submerged in. Creator's plan, how he speaks to each of us. We are all born with a purpose. We cross paths for a reason, because there are no accidents. Everything is part of the Creator's plan. What role do we each have to play? That depends on the gifts we each have been blessed with, and the choices we each make on how we use those gifts to make this a better world. Bear all this in mind as you hear my words. Hakita, hear me. The culture of deception and denial. In 1636, 16 years after the landing of the Pilgrims, in the summer of that year, only 17 years after the Pilgrim landing, in the land of the Massachusetts, the first known American-made slave ship, the Desire, was built in Marblehead, Massachusetts. Partitioned with coffin-sized compartments and supplied with armaments on Governor John Winthrop's order. The following year, as I speak, you need to connect the dots so you won't say you don't know things happen. On May 26th, which happens to be the same date of my father's birthday on that anniversary. In the year 1637, the first major massacre in U.S. history takes place. At that time, dawn is born out of the darkness. But on the morning of May 26, 1637, dawn became darkness when Captain John Mason, in the service of Connecticut Colony, marched into the Pequot Fort, overlooking the Mystic River, and set fire to the wigwams inside with the torch he held in his hand. The conflagration he ignited burst into the roaring inferno
that blazed with such a vicious fury that within but a single hour it had burned itself out. When the last agonizing shriek of the over 300 Pequots was finally silenced, as the extremely intense smell of burning flesh permeated the air. The fire Captain Mason had in his hand was not so great as the one he had in his heart, because within that single hour it had burned itself out. But the fire in his heart was fueled by the bigotry, greed, and intolerance, and racism that still burns today and will continue to destroy many, many more, unless it is extinguished. We know the attitudes responsible for that blaze have survived because we have never read their obituary. Those of our people who have survived recognize too well this destructive fire that still burns because we have continued to feel the heat of it for the past 380 years. It has been our legacy. It is our thread of connection to our past and why we cannot forget it, or we will forget who we are. Do the lives of people of color matter? Most obviously not to Captain John Mason, the English military leader, who marched into the fort with that torch in his hand and set fire to the tinder dry wigwams, making that torch the weapon of mass destruction that would expedite the slaughter, that would help to, quote unquote, clear the title to the land. Simply because there was not a deluge of media coverage to serve as eyewitness to the vicious brutality of the slaughter of over 400 men, women, and children at the fort, only 17 short years after the arrival of the pilgrims, does not remove that reality from this nation's past. The victims of this savage attack, having no cell phones to record the blood-curdling screams of the painfully hideous sound, has denied them the opportunity that more recent victims of blatant injustice in our land have had. The cries of such pain as the flames dance around their burning bodies, gasping for breath, was never preserved on the videotape that could have documented this atrocity, that could have most graphically challenged the sanitized historical accounts that have become part of the culture of denial of this nation. As those flames whipped by the strong winds uphill from the Mystic River at the break of day, burned with such fury, there was nothing left but ashes when the winds finally subsided. Instead of questioning the morality of the deliberate slaughter of the beautiful and totally innocent little Indian babies who were guilty of nothing but the aboriginal sin, the crime of being born Indian, their respected religious leaders rejoiced with days of prayer, quote unquote, prayer and thanksgiving for the destruction of their enemies. Because these atrocities that were repeated from sea to shining sea as we became the roadkill of the Pilgrim's March of Progress have been surgically removed in order to make patriotism possible, present-day Americans have mistakenly defined the attack on the World Trade Center as, quote unquote, the worst act of terrorism on US soil. At this point, let us go back and connect a few dots from then and now. If we don't develop that capacity as we look at our history, we run the real risk of not learning the lessons that are there and the important legacy that has come out of the events and all attitudes. If we want to see what is wrong with the society that has been transplanted here on Indian land, with all of the myths, misconceptions, and contradictions we have all been the victims of, we must look at this both honestly and completely if we want to begin to learn the lessons that history has to teach. When we look back at that torch Captain John Mason had in his hand, we need to realize that it was not so great as the one he had in his heart. Because I told you within that single hour it burned itself out. But that racism still burns today and will continue to destroy many, many more unless it is extinguished. This is our thread of connection to our past, and we cannot forget it. We have felt that the heat of that torch burned all the brighter since President Barack Obama has been in the White House, as it accelerates to a level that is completely toxic. Just as Captain John Mason was completely unable to tolerate the Pequot being in his way, those who worship his ideals simply refuse to accept a black man in the White House when they can only dehumanize him because of his color. God bless America. Instead of acknowledging the grisly butchery that took place there in Mystic, the beneficiaries of that injustice in the foundation of this society chose instead to honor the butcher a full 252 years later. After the Mystic Massacre and all the many others that it initiated, such as Sand Creek and the others that were mentioned earlier, okay? From sea to shining sea. On June 26, 1889, when my Pequot grandfather was 14 years old, living in Pequot territory, the statue of Captain John Mason, costing over $9,000 for the westerly granite base alone, rising to 20 feet in height, was unveiled with so much pomp and ceremony by countless dignitaries, historians, and clergymen, with one flowery speech after another, all singing the praises of the butcher who burned the babies. Because of the immunity to learning the lessons that history has to teach, my grandfather, at the age of 15, after the unveiling of the John Mason statue, would read about the last major massacre in U.S. history at a place called Wounded Knee, South Dakota, where the U.S. Army opened fire on 200 old men, women, and children on December 29, 1890, 4 days after Christmas, the season of goodwill towards men. After the frozen bodies were buried like rubbish in a mass grave, some of the soldiers were honored with medals, and another monument had to be built to that brutality. Show me a nation's monument, and I will show you what they worship. A nation that honors the violent will always have violence. A nation that honors racists will always have racism. A nation that honors the greedy will always have greed. A nation that honors the intolerant will always have intolerance. A nation that honors hypocrites will always have hypocrisy. But a nation that honors terrorists will always have terrorism. If you understand these statements and can connect the dots, you should not have to echo the statement so many in the media have used by describing the brutal slaughter of the nine angels in the Emmanuel AME Church on June 17th as the quote, unquote, incomprehensible. If you understand that, we live in a nation that has accepted and even attempted to justify violence ever since the arrival of the pilgrims, and the written historical record, because of the sanitized history we've all been the victims of. You should not be surprised there was no mention made connecting the Newtown Massacre with the Mystic Massacre, only around a 2-hour ride away from where that took place. 3.5 centuries earlier. By the same token, the Aurora, Colorado Massacre that took place on around an hour's ride away from the Sand Creek Massacre, mentioned earlier, where 150 Native Americans, some estimates are placed even higher, were brutally slaughtered In 1864, during the time of the Civil War, not by a deranged individual, but by the U.S. military, who were never punished, but hailed as heroes. This is Captain John Mason had done when he set that example. Should it be any wonder that the U.S. murder rate would be 20 times that of other developed countries? Connect those dots. Now, while I have my zoom lens out, before I finish my portion here, let us now take a look at the Liberty Bell and the true American terrorists. At the time when the Liberty Bell rang, near the beginning of the American Revolution, or Euro-American Revolution, 539,000 black Americans were owned by 2,600,000 white colonists in the year 1776. The Liberty Bell, weighing 2,000 pounds, was made in 1752 in London, England, while the African slave trade was flourishing here in the English colonies. And 1,236 slaves were brought across the Atlantic that year on Rhode Island slave ships alone, the state where I grew up and spent all of my life. While this symbol of freedom was being made in England, John Newton, the English slave trader, was still involved in the industry he later described as despicable when he found the quote-unquote amazing grace that we all sing of today. Land-hungry colonists, the true American terrorists, who have immortalized the bell as so sacred, were pushing the so-called frontier further and further into Indian country to increase their real estate holdings. Any Indians who dared to resist this violation of their freedoms were either slaughtered or beaten to submission. To maximize the profits that could be made on the newly confiscated Indian lands, more and more black slaves had to be uprooted from their natural lands in Africa and carried here on slave ships that often were more like floating slaughterhouses to provide the free labor for the colonists. The common ingredient in this triangular recipe was the New England rum, which could not be produced fast enough to satisfy the insatiable appetite in this industry, this vulture industry. As the American dream was constructed thus at our expense, the Liberty Bell was rung on July the 8th, 1776, in Philadelphia to proclaim liberty throughout all the land and unto all the inhabitants thereof, quote unquote, in the book of Leviticus, chapter 25, verse 10. The slaughter and subjugation of any Native Americans who dared to resist the robbing of their freedoms by people who claimed to be fighting for their own perceived freedoms personified a contradiction so obvious that it should be questioned by anyone of conscience. It has to make one wonder, does America even have a conscience? Or has greed for the almighty dollar robbed the society of any conscience it might have had? One would have to wonder if the predatory for-profit society, which was established in the land of opportunity, would still be so firmly in place had the extremely obvious contradiction been questioned, sincerely and completely. But instead of questioning the contradiction posed by what the Liberty Bell supposedly proclaimed, the bell was rung all the louder to drown out the question and the cries of anguish of the Native Americans being slaughtered and deceived, and of the suffocating slaves crowded into the filthy ships, for many of them died in their own waste before they could even be sold. It is no wonder that this Liberty Bell finally cracked in 1835, as the many completely legitimate struggles for freedom were being fought on the steadily advancing frontier in the territories of the West, and some of the most expensive real estate today, in the land of the seminaries, which you now call Florida. There are no accidents, as I said. Everything is part of the Creator's plan. If it's called an accident, when we do not know this plan, what we often call coincidence, I heard that word mentioned earlier, is in reality a God incident. We therefore all share an obligation, all of us, everyone here in this room, everyone on this earth, we all share an obligation to learn the many lessons the Creator has placed in His plan. And He placed those lessons in His plan before Jesus. America's progress in this area is retarded by its denial and hypocrisy. When you don't learn the lesson that history has to teach, you are doomed to repeat them, as we now see in the evening news. Webster's Collegiate Dictionary defines terror as a state of intense fear. It defines terrorist as a person or thing causing intense fear. Describes terrorism as an act of terrorizing, use of force or threats to demoralize, intimidate, and subjugate, especially such use as a political weapon or policy. Once you understand how terrorism is at the very foundation of America, it then becomes easier to understand how most of an entire continent has left the hands of the native people of this land as the American dream has been constructed at our expense. Through many years of research and spiritual guidance from my ancestors, who can finally have a voice in my words, the details of that 397-year process can now set us all free, so the promise of America can now be realized. In America, freedom does not ring. It drums. Let freedom drum. Let freedom drum. Let freedom drum.
Oh,
That was absolutely beautiful.
I'm going to ask them that.
I want to note to everyone that it is afternoon. We were going to break for lunch at noon, so we're happy to continue answering questions here. We're going to pick back up at 1:30, right? There's going to be a dining from 1 to 1:30. I think that's